Hodder and Stoughton Audio presents Auntie Poldi and the Sicilian Lions. Auntie Poldi Mysteries, Book 1. By Mario Giordano. Read for you by Matt Addis. Chapter 1. Describes how and why Poldi moves to Sicily and what her sisters-in-law think of it. Unable to function without her wig and a bottle of brandy, Poldi invites everyone to a roast pork lunch, makes her nephew an offer he can't refuse, and gets to know her neighbours in the Via Baronessa. One of them goes missing shortly afterwards. On her 60th birthday, my Auntie Poldi moved to Sicily, intending to drink herself comfortably to death with a sea view. That, at least, was what we were all afraid of. But something always got in the way. Sicily is complicated. You can't simply die there. Something always gets in the way. Then events speeded up, and someone was murdered, and nobody admitted to having seen or known a thing. It goes without saying that my Auntie Poldi, being the pig-headed Bavarian she was, had to take matters in hand herself and sort them out. And that was when problems arose. My Auntie Poldi, a glamorous figure, always ready to make a dramatic entrance. She had put on a bit of weight in recent years, admittedly, and booze and depression had ploughed a few furrows in her outward appearance, but she was still an attractive woman, and mentally tip-top, most of the time at least. Stylish, anyway. When Madonna's Music came out, Poldi was the first woman in Westermühlstrasse to wear a white Stetson. One of my earliest childhood memories is of her and Uncle Beppe sitting on my parents' patio in Neufahrn, Poldi in a bright orange trouser suit, beer in one hand, cigarette in the other, and everyone joining in the laughter she seemed to generate with her entire body, which erupted from her in inexhaustible gusts of mirth, interspersed with the smutty jokes and expletives that made me the star attraction of the school playground when I passed them on the next day. Isolde and Giuseppe had met at a Munich television studio, where Poldi worked as a costume designer and Beppe was a tailor, an occupation which, for want of any other talent or aspiration, he had inherited from his tyrannical and hypochondriacal father. In other words, my grandfather, who had likewise lacked any talents or aspirations. Quite unlike his father, my great-grandfather Barnaba, that is, who, without being able to speak a word of German, had emigrated in the 1920s to Munich, where he set up a lucrative wholesale fruit business and became a wealthy man. But I digress. Poldi and my Uncle Pepe had shared a grand passion. But alas, a few things went badly wrong. Two miscarriages, booze, my uncle's womanizing, divorce from my uncle's illness, my uncle's death, the whole issue of the plot of land in Tanzania, and sundry other unpleasant twists and turns, setbacks and upheavals of life had stricken my aunt with depression. But she continued to laugh, love, and drink a lot. And she didn't simply take things lying down when they went against the grain, which they always did. Poldi had enjoyed being a costume designer, but in recent years she had more and more often lost jobs to younger colleagues. Television work had become scarcer, times harder, and Poldi had gradually fallen out of love with her profession. Stupidly enough, the disastrous venture in Tanzania had robbed her of almost all her savings. But then her parents died in quick succession and left her their little house on the outskirts of Augsburg. And because my Auntie Poldi had always hated the house and everything to do with it, nothing could have been more logical than to sell it and take herself off, together with the rest of her savings and her small pension, and fulfill one of her dearest wishes, to die with a sea view and family for company. The family in Sicily naturally suspected that Poldi meant to hasten her demise with a glass or two, given her depressive tendencies, and felt that this must be combated on every level and by all available means. When I say family, I'm referring principally to my three aunts, Teresa, Caterina, and Luisa, and my uncle Martino, Teresa's husband. Aunt Teresa, who calls the shots in our family, tried to persuade Poldi to move in with them at Catania, if only for social reasons. "Don't be daft, Poldi," Teresa lamented in her best Munich dialect. "Why would you want to live out there all on your lonesome? Move in near us, then you'd always have someone to chew the fat and play cards with, and you can do everything on foot. Theatre, cinema, supermarket and hospital. Everything's practically on the doorstep. We've even got a few good-looking policemen, too." Not a chance, though. Poldi's private agreement with her melancholia stipulated a sea view. And a sea view was what she got, together with a breathtaking panorama from her roof terrace. The sea straight ahead, and Etna behind. What more would anyone want? The only snag, with her bad knee, Poldi could hardly make it up the stairs to the roof. A sleepy, friendly little town on the east coast of Sicily, midway between Catania and Taormina, Torre Achirafi is unsuited to any form of tourist exploitation, gentrification, or vandalism because of its coastline, which consists of massive, jagged volcanic cliffs. Or so one would think, anyway. This doesn't, in fact, deter the inhabitants from dumping their rubbish on the beach, making life as difficult for each other as possible, and in the summer shoehorning timber platforms and snack bars into the gaps between the cliffs. On weekends, families and young people from Catania throng there to sunbathe, eat, read paperbacks, squabble, eat, listen to the radio, eat, and flirt. Forever bombarded by the thump of indeterminate bass rhythms and dazed by a miasma of coconut oil, frying fat, and fatalism. And in the midst of it all, my Auntie Poldi. She liked the place. I've never known why. Winters in Torre, on the other hand, are dank. A sea the colour of lead snarls at the projecting breakwaters, as if intent on swallowing the whole town, and its moist, salty breath adorns every ceiling with black efflorescences of mildew. Air conditioning and feeble central heating systems don't stand a chance. My Auntie Poldi had to have the whole house whitewashed the very first April after she moved into the Via Baronessa, and again every year thereafter. Winters in Torre aren't much fun, but at least they're short. For shopping, one drives to nearby Riposto, or better still, straight through to the Hyper Simply supermarket, where everything's on tap. All Torre itself has to offer is Signor Busacca's little tabacchi for basic necessities. The bar Gelateria Cocuzza, presided over by the sad signora, and a restaurant even the local cats steer clear of. Torre Achirafi does, however, boast a mineral water spring. And although the bottling plant down by the harbour was closed in the 70s, Acqua di Torre still means something to my aunts. Protruding from the side of the old building is a row of brass taps, from which the inhabitants of Torre can still draw their own mineral water free of charge. "What does it taste like?" I asked politely, the first time Poldi enthused about the public mineral water supply as though speaking of a chocolate fountain. "Frightful, of course. What do you expect? Still, local patriotism makes folk thirsty." My Uncle Martino, who used to be a sales representative for a firm supplying banks with safes and cash registers, and whose knowledge of Sicily is second to none, spent a whole month driving Poldi back and forth between Siracusa and Taormina in search of a suitable house. My aunts had at least managed to persuade her to restrict herself to no more than 1 hour's drive from Catania, but no house fulfilled Poldi's requirements. She always found something to criticize, find fault with, or deride. Fundamentally, however, she had only one rather esoteric criterion. "It's quite simple, you know," Poldi once confided to me in a hoarse whisper. "I can always sense it right away. There are good places with good vibes, and bad places with bad vibes, and there's nothing in between. It's digital, so to speak. It's the binary structure of happiness."
"The what?"
"Stop interrupting me all the time. I can sense it at once if a place is good or bad. It may be a town, a house, an apartment. No matter, I sense it at once. The energy, The calmer, whether the ice is thick enough, know what I mean? I can simply sense it. But not in the case of any of the houses the aunts picked out for her. The ice was never thick enough, and even Uncle Martino became gradually demoralized by this, which is saying something, because he usually becomes perkier the longer he spends behind the steering wheel, spurning the air conditioning, never drinking a drop of water, even in August, and inhaling as much cigarette smoke as air. I remember going on excursions with Uncle Martino when my first dose of sunburn prompted me to take a brief respite from the beach during the summer holidays. Excursions. 12-hour drives through a Dantean inferno. Through air like molten glass, without water or air conditioning, in a Fiat Regata thick with smoke. If I wound down the passenger window, the Sirocco scorched and scoured my cheeks, so I preferred to go on inhaling tobacco fumes. Meanwhile, Uncle Martino talked at me without a break. He pontificated on Sicilian history, the source of the best pistachio nuts, Lord Nelson and the Bronte siblings, life in the Middle Ages, Frederick II, Palermo's Vucciria market, tuna shoals, overfishing by Japanese trawlers, and the mosaics of Monreale. He commented on Radio Radicale's live broadcasts of debates in the Italian Parliament. He lectured me on the Cyclops, the Greeks, the Normans, General Patton, Lucky Luciano, and yellow silk scarves. On the only acceptable way of making a granita. On angels, demons, the Trinacria, the truth about Kafka and communism, and the relationship between physical stature and criminality in the male population of Sicily. His rule of thumb, the shorter the man, the more threatening and the more likely to be a mafioso. That I scarcely understood a word didn't bother him. My Italian was appalling. In fact, it was practically non-existent apart from one or two helpful swear words and che schifo, allucinante, birra, compana, bo, be, and ma, which constituted an adolescent's vocabulary on the beach. My Uncle Martino couldn't have cared less, even when I no longer had the energy to show any sign of life. He simply drove on, smoking, holding forth, and becoming younger and more chipper by the hour, like a kind of Sicilian Dorian Gray. Between times, in the rare moments when he briefly fell silent in order to light another cigarette, he would whisper his wife's name. Teresa? Just like that. Quite suddenly. As if she was somewhere nearby, possibly in the boot or under the back seat, and he had something important to tell her. Teresa! There was no need to respond to this strange, affectionate invocation, and Aunt Teresa once assured me that she heard him call her every time, no matter how far away he was. From time to time, we used to pull up outside a bank in some shabby provincial town. There, I would at last get a Coke, while Uncle Martino drank a café with the bank manager, clinched a deal, or laid his expert hand on a safe door that had got stuck, whereupon it would miraculously spring open. He was full of professional tricks, was my Uncle Martino. One of them was looking for mushrooms, but he also showed me occult Templar frescoes in octagonal Romanesque churches, cool secret passages in Arabo-Norman castles, and obscene stucco reliefs in Baroque palaces, all of them discoveries made on his trips across Sicily. No one knows the island better than my Uncle Martino, but finding a suitable house for Poldi was a task that severely tested his fund of experience and local knowledge, indeed, his entire savoir-faire. My tactic for the first few days, he admitted to me, was to wear Poldi down and soften her up so she'd make her mind up quickly and buy a house in the neighbourhood. Driving round for hours, heat exhaustion, frustration, a war of attrition, in fact. But your Auntie Poldi is simply indestructible, a human tank. She cursed and groaned, the sweat streamed down her face from under a wig like beer from a leaky barrel, but she wouldn't give up. She's tough, that woman. Madonna, I tried everything. So how did you find the house in the end?
Pure chance.
He puffed at his cigarette in silence. I waited, saying nothing. Another form of attrition. One that never fails with Martino because he wants to speak. Can't help unbosoming himself. All right, listen. Last day, late afternoon, we've already viewed 5 houses. I'm at the end of my tether and in urgent need of a cafe, so I take the next turning off the Provinciale. To Torre Akirafi. I told you, pure chance. We didn't have any house there on our list. We simply have a cafe and a little bar, you know, the one with the sad signora behind the counter, and I get chatting with some man about this and that. And Poldi, she's getting itchy feet again, wants to drive on, but I refuse to be bullied, need a break. Order another cafe and go on chatting with a nice man. Poldi can't stand it any longer, storms out of the bar, and vanishes.
Poldi vanishes? How do you mean?
Madonna, that's a figure of speech, of course. She just doesn't come back. After a while, I get worried and go looking for her. Cigarette stubbed out, another shaken out of the packet and ignited.
But you can't find her,
I prompted, trying to get him back on track.
It's like the place has simply swallowed her up. So I accost a priest who's just come in my way and give him a description of Poldi. The Reverend Father promptly beams at me. He's already in the picture. Ah, yes, the charming Signora Poldina from Munich. He also knows my name and all our family relationships, knows where house hunting and points out a former fisherman's house halfway along the street in which we're standing. And what do I see? A ruin, I tell you. Totally dilapidated, nothing but cats and lizards, ivy and ghosts. But when I go nearer, I see Poldi already striding around inside the old volcanic stone walls and stamping her feet in high delight.
The ice is thick enough, she calls out when she sees me. This is it. This is a good place. Did you see the name of the street? Great vibes. Really pure, positive energy.
Her exact words.
This is my house,
she kept saying. It was no use arguing, you know what she's like.
But was the house for sale?
Are you joking? Haven't you been listening?
Uncle Martino clasped his hands together as if in prayer and shook them vigorously.
A ruin!
Needless to say, there was an old Vendisi notice stuck to the wall, complete with phone number. The owner couldn't believe his luck when Poldi called him. The rest, you know. She paid too much for that ruin, if you ask me. She'd have done better to invest in a better bathroom for you on the top floor. I don't know if my Auntie Poldi paid too much for the house in the Via Baronessa, nor do I care in the least. Generous people can't be conned, and Poldi is the most generous person I know. She has never expected something for nothing or tried to beat someone down. Everyone who helped her got well paid, including the builders, the dustman, and Valentino, and she always left a decent tip in the restaurant. It wasn't that she had money to throw around. She wasn't that well off, but it simply wasn't that important to her. Anyway, the fact is, she scored a bullseye in buying that house. This was confirmed by my cousin Giro, who's an architect and ought to know. In the course of the next year, he restored the Via Baronessa house exactly in accordance with Poldi's wishes and her modest financial means. It was a narrow but genuinely handsome house, situated one row back from the sea. Neither too small nor too big, it had 3 floors, a baroque balcony, a small inner courtyard, and the aforesaid roof terrace with spectacular views of the sea and the volcano. Wedged into a shady side street behind the esplanade, it was painted bright violet and sunny yellow, with green shutters and a big brass plate announcing the name of the person who resided at number 29 Via Baronessa, Isolde Oberreiter. My Auntie Poldi. Plus, up in the attic every few weeks, her nephew from Germany. Like her ebony African idols and her pair of life-size China poodles, I kind of belonged to the decor from the outset. A year later, the house was ready to move into. The Munich apartment empty, save for a few wraiths of memories, and the removals van bound for the Alps, the Apennines and Etna. In the meantime, Poldi's old Alfa Romeo was parked on Westermühlstrasse, tanked up and fully laden, waiting to set off on its last long trip.
waiting for me too. Poldi was scared stiff of flying, and couldn't be expected to drive that far on her own while sober, so the aunts had browbeaten me into chauffeuring her from Munich to Torre Acquirafi.
"Your time will be your own,"
I was told on the phone by my aunt Caterina, the voice of reason in our family.
"You'll be independent, and you can write just as well down here with us, maybe even better."
Her subtext, "Since you're unemployed and work shy anyway, and you don't even have a girlfriend, although other men your age have long since acquired a wife and kids, you might just as well loaf around here. Who knows, maybe something will come of it." Which it eventually did. Between Munich and Torre Acquirafi, however, I was faced with a 34-hour drive in Isolde's overpowered 1980s Alfa, equipped with roll bars, which she flatly refused to exchange for a more practical Panda and seldom drove anyway because you had to be certifiably sober to do so.
"We could always drive to Genoa and take it easy on the ferry over to Palermo,"
I suggested timidly, but Poldi just eyed me with scorn. My mistake. I should have known. If there was one phrase she detested from the bottom of her heart, it was, "take it easy."
"Well, if it's too much for you."
"No, no, it's all right," I grunted, and we puttered off, never doing over 60 miles an hour as we slunk across the Brenner Pass and trickled down the whole of the Italian boot past Milan, Rome, and Naples, keeping to the Autostrada all the way to Reggio Calabria. We devoured our first arancini di riso on the ferry between Scilia and Charybdis, and got lost in Messina, where Poldi insisted on driving the final stretch to Torre herself. She revved the asthmatic Alfa and stepped on it. When we got to Torre, I kissed the ground and thanked the Mother of God for my salvation and resurrection.
"Many happy returns," I sighed,
because it was the very day my Auntie Poldi turned 60. My Uncle Martino and the aunts came to Torre every few days to see how Poldi was getting on.
The thing was, my aunts had a project, to keep Poldi alive for as long as possible,
or at least to help raise her spirits. For Sicilians, joie de vivre rests on two pillars, good food and talking, arguing about good food. Uncle Martino, for example, went to his temple, Catania's fish market, every day. Not a very entertaining place, more a kind of stock exchange where men lounge with tense concentration, checking the quality and price of the fish on offer and speculating on tuna belly meat or on whether a belated fisherman will turn up with a swordfish when everyone else's needs have been met and they can buy it more cheaply and fresher than fresh. This can take hours and isn't much fun either. Alternatively, Uncle Martino will take Aunt Teresa mushroom picking on Etna. He once drove all round the volcano to buy bread, and for eggs he goes to a car repair shop near Lentini, whose owner's mutant hens lay eggs with two yolks. Granita is only to be consumed at the Café Cipriani in Aciriali. Cannoli alla crema di ricotta can only come from the Pasticceria Savia in Via Etenea in Catania. Once, when I praised the Pasticceria Russo in Santa Venerina for its marzipan, my uncle merely growled disparagingly, then drove there with me at once to check on the matter in situ and subsequently commended me on my palate. Cherries have to come from Sant'Alfio, pistachios from Bronte, potatoes from Giare, and wild fennel from one particular top-secret old lava field where, if you're in luck and the Terranovas haven't got there first, you can find oyster mushrooms the size of your hand. Arancini di riso have to be eaten at Urna in San Giovanni la Punta, and pizzas at Il Tocco, beneath the Provinciale and just beyond the Esso garage. The tastiest mandarins come from Siracusa, and the tastiest figs, whatever their ultimate provenance, from the street vendor in San Gregorio. If you ever eat fish outside your own four walls, the only place to do so is Don Carmelo's in Santa Maria la Scala, which also serves the best pasta al nero di seppia. Life is complicated on an island imprisoned in a stranglehold of crisis and corruption, where men still live with their parents until marriage or their mid-40s for lack of employment. but no culinary compromises are ever made. That was what Poldi had always liked about Sicily, being inquisitive and sensual by nature. All she considered execrable was my uncle's taste in wine, for neither he nor the aunts were great drinkers. Sicilians in general drank little, a glass with their meals at most. This initially presented Poldi with a problem, until she discovered the Iper Simpli's wine department, and later on Gaetano Avola's vineyard in Zafarana. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Poldi's day always began with a revivifying Prosecco. Then came an espresso with a dash of brandy, followed by a slug of brandy without the espresso. Sometimes, when in a more than usually melancholy frame of mind, she would walk to Priola, a remote little pebbly beach. An enchanted place, with water as clear as liquid cobalt, it was sprinkled with lumps of lava sculpted into black and rust-brown dinosaurs' eggs by the ebb and flow of the sea. She usually had it all to herself. In high summer, it wasn't until later in the day that families came with their radios, picnic baskets, cool boxes, rubber rings and sun umbrellas, and strewed the little beach with litter until by October it resembled a rubbish dump until it was scoured clean again by the winter storms. My Auntie Poldi would sometimes dip her feet in the limpid water, toss a particularly handsome dinosaur's egg into the sea in memory of my Uncle Pepe, fold her hands and say,
"Namaste, life,"
followed by
"Poldi contra mundum."
At 11 in the morning came the first beer, accompanied by Umberto Tozzi belting out the 1979 pop song Gloria at a volume that would have driven even Sheila and Charybdis insane. When my cousins came visiting, we used to sing the song together, but substituting Poldi for Gloria, you might say it became a kind of anthem. Strangely enough, the neighbours never complained. Strangely enough, they took to Poldi from day one, toted her shopping home for her, carried out minor repairs in the house, accompanied her on visits to officialdom, and invited her to play cards. No matter what had gone wrong in my aunt's life, everyone felt good in her company. The neighbours called her simply Donna Poldina. The neighbours. Signora Anzalone and her husband on the left, both elderly. The house on the right belonged to a Dottore Branciforti, a tax consultant from Catania, but he only came on weekends with his mistress or during the summer months with his wife and children, if at all. At the end of the street lived Elio Busacca, who owned the tabacchi on the corner and eventually found Valentino for my aunt. For the first few weeks after Poldi's move, everything seemed to be going according to plan. Having installed her old furniture, the peasant cupboards, her father's collection of antique weapons, her ebony African idols and her china knick-knacks, she raised a glass to the sea and the volcano in turn. Before toasting Etna, she always paid tribute to the mighty smoker by firing up an MS, a morto sicuro, or certain death, as the Italians call that brand of cigarettes, to go with her brandy. The heat seemed to drip off her like dew off a lotus leaf, although the sweat trickled down from under her wig. Ah, that wig. She'd worn one for as long as I could remember. A huge black monster, variously dressed in accordance with the prevailing fashion, it loomed above her head like a storm cloud. According to family legend, no one had ever seen what lay hidden beneath it. Even my Uncle Pepe had been vague on the subject. I suspect that Vito Montana was later privileged to peek beneath that holiest of holies, but he too preserved a discreet silence. On the very first Sunday after moving in, Poldi invited the aunts, my cousins, and me, still recovering in the attic guest room from our drive, to lunch. Roast pork with beer gravy, dumplings, and red cabbage. In mid-July. In Sicily. We were welcomed with tumblerfuls of a dry martini strong enough to send a Finnish seaman into a coma. While Poldi was inside thickening the gravy, alternately adding beer and drinking some herself, we huddled together under the only awning in the little courtyard like penguins in a storm. Still, lunch already smelt delicious.
When Poldi finally emerged with a monstrous great leg of roast pork, bathed in sweat and explosively red in the face, I jumped to my feet in a panic.
"For goodness sake, come into the shade, Poldi."
But my Auntie Poldi merely, as so often, gazed at me pityingly.
"You think I came to Sicily to sit in the shade? I want sun, proper sun, sun with some oomph to it. Il sole.
The sun is masculine in Italy, like the sea and the volcano, and they're what I came here for, so sit down, all of you. I'll go and get the dumplings." It really was a poem, that roast pork. La fine del mondo, even in a temperature of 40 degrees. My cousins, who regarded German cuisine with a certain scepticism, were hesitant at first, but after the first polite mouthful, they tucked in. They still wouldn't touch the red cabbage, but no one was deterred by the heat.
"Hey," my Auntie Poldi said out of the blue, "how are you getting back to Germany?"
I shrugged. "You can book me a flight any time soon?" She shook her head as if I'd said something extremely stupid.
"Well, don't you like it up there in the guest room?"
Yes, of course.
"Doing any writing?"
"Uh-huh."
"Can I read some of it?"
The last question I wanted.
"Well, not at the moment, Poldi. It's still in a state of flux, work in progress."
I had rashly told her during the drive about my self-destructive plan to write a big, epic family saga spanning 3 German-Sicilian generations. A regular doorstop of a novel, full-bodied, juicy, masterfully told, full of twists and turns, replete with brilliant images, quirky characters, stubble-chinned villains, ethereal beauties, plenty of sex, amateur entanglements, escapades, scorching days and velvety nights, and a brim with historical strands running parallel to the plot. The only trouble was, I'd made no progress at all. Writer's block. Total paralysis. I felt like Sisyphus within the first few feet. I told Poldi all this between the Brenner Pass and Messina, and she'd merely nodded, being an expert on failure.
"I was only thinking," she said. "If you like it up there, you could stay on. Or come here now and then, regularly, I mean, to write and do your research. It'd do your Italian good, too."
I sighed. "Thanks. No pressure, then." But for some reason, my Auntie Poldi wouldn't let the matter drop.
"I just don't understand what more you want. Up there you have your own bathroom and your own peace and quiet. You can come and go as you please, and if something turns up on the amore front, you're welcome to bring her home any time."
That was all I needed. My aunts naturally endorsed the idea with enthusiasm. It meant they would have a family member on the spot to keep an eye on Poldi. And when Aunt Teresa invited me to lunch the following Sunday, I knew further resistance was futile. After all, I told myself, even a failure can feast his eyes on the sea. That's something, at least. And so I flew down from Germany once a month at the aunt's expense, lodged in the attic at number 29 Via Baronessa, chafed at my mediocrity during the day, and in the evening, if my Auntie Poldi was tipsy enough, marvelled at her accounts of the progress of her investigations into Valentino's murder.
Chapter 2
Tells of Valentino, of Poldi's ultra-private photographic project, of afternoons in Torre Akirafi, and of sad Signora Cocuzza. Poldi becomes anxious and is nearly killed by some palm trees. She snaffles something in Asci Reali and soon afterwards discovers a small but heavily guarded paradise, which has been bereft of a lion. Valentino was a quiet, slim young man of not quite 20. He was one of those Sicilian types in whom Sicily's Arabo-Norman heritage shows through. Olive complexion, broad nose, generous mouth, blue eyes.
"A good-looking lad,"
was Poldi's verdict.
"Just as sexy as my Pepe used to be. One could really take a shine to him."
Believe it or not, despite her 60 years and ample figure, Poldi was still in great demand, certainly to judge by the glances she got from the local menfolk. She had always been a hottie, and a fan of men in general, especially men in dapper police uniforms.
That became clear to me when she showed me the photo albums containing her collection. The fact was, Poldi had a hobby: photographing good-looking traffic cops from all over the world. Having travelled widely in the previous 30 years, she had filled 5 capacious albums with steam-ironed, uniformed masculinity from Alaska to Australia, Belgrade to Buenos Aires. All the photos were neatly dated, and many bore names, indicating that Poldi had become better acquainted with the custodians of the law in question. Tattooed Maoris in snow-white shorts posed for the camera. A mustachioed Sikh in immaculate khaki brandished his lathi, and mounted New York cops wearing mirrored sunglasses bared their teeth. It was a proud parade of dapper figures, well-pressed trousers and bristling moustaches. Canadian Mounties in their flaming red full-dress uniforms, narrow-hipped Scots in black and white, short-legged Bolivians in olive drab and snappy berets, wistful Siberian youngsters in fur caps. My Auntie Poldi had snapped them all. But her favourite subjects were the Vigili Urbani. At least half the photos were of Italian traffic cops in their white gloves and, in some cases, white tropical helmets.
The handsomest ones are in Rome, by far, no comparison, absolutely unbeatable, graceful as Nureyev, every last one of them. Their hand movements, their uniforms, perfect. But don't go thinking they'd ever smile. They never smile until they're off duty, as I know from personal experience. But here, look, I spotted a prize specimen in Taormina the day before yesterday.
On Wednesdays, Poldi attended a language school belonging to Michele, a friend of my cousin Ciro's, so Wednesday was the only day of the week on which she stayed sober. Her Italian was quite sufficient for everyday use, but that wasn't good enough for her.
"Why the stress?" I once asked her. "Why bother when you're planning to drink yourself to death?"
Clumsy of me, very clumsy, to voice my other aunt's suspicion so explicitly.
"What sort of idiotic question is that?"
she barked at me.
"Until you've mastered the passato remoto, my boy, keep your pearls of wisdom to yourself, understand?"
At all events, Poldi had photographed an exceptionally smart vigile in Taormina and planned to make his acquaintance at the next opportunity. He wasn't in the first flush of youth, with his neatly trimmed beard and moustache and little pot belly, but he wore his immaculate uniform with the enviable arrogance of a good-looking chump whose mama still irons his shirts. But back to Valentino. He wasn't a chump, although he still lived with his parents, as a matter of course, but he hadn't managed to land a traineeship or a regular job. He really wasn't a stupid youth, as Poldi quickly realized. Like many young Sicilians, he coped by doing odd jobs and toyed with the idea of emigrating to Germany. Sicilians find it a cinch to emigrate for decades. Bag packed, bacio, addio, and off they go. Valentino helped Poldi with the minor repairs that became necessary soon after the renovation of her house. No disrespect to my cousin Ciro, but his builders had made a rotten job of the roof. When I went to change the bulb in the top floor bathroom, the bowl shade tipped a Niagara of rainwater over me. A miracle I wasn't electrocuted. Valentino could change fuses, put up pictures, repair the air conditioning, and go shopping at the Iper Simply. He was a multi-talented youngster, and Poldi soon took him to her heart, in which, as everyone knew, there was plenty of room. She even gave him German lessons, not that the accent he acquired would have made him comprehensible outside Bavaria, but in any case the Germany project came to nothing because early in August Valentino suddenly vanished without a trace. Poldi waited a whole day for him to fulfil his promise to clear a blocked drain. She didn't take it amiss if someone stood her up once, but when she heard nothing from Valentino the next day, and the day after that, and he failed to answer his mobile, she became puzzled, angry, and worried in turn. It dawned on her only then how little she really knew about him. She did know his surname, which was Candela, but she hadn't the faintest idea where he lived. Signora Anzalone hadn't even noticed Valentina's disappearance. and Signor Busacca merely shrugged his shoulders.
Boh, where else would he be? He'll have hooked up with some girl. He'll turn up again sooner or later.
Poldi was neither reassured nor convinced by this.
When was the last time you saw him?
Busacca thought for a moment.
Yesterday?
No, it must have been the day before. Or Monday. Yes, Monday. He bought a packet of Lucky Strike and 50 euros worth of credit for his mobile phone. Poldi remembered this. On Monday, after hefting the heavy pot containing the lemon tree onto the roof terrace, Valentino had opened a new packet of cigarettes, scratched a new telephone card, and activated the voucher code via his mobile.
Do you remember which phone company the Scheda Telefonica was for?
Tim. The others had run out.
Recalling the blue and red card, Poldi felt puzzled once more. Because Valentino had always charged his mobile with a red and white card before, it now occurred to her that he had also been in possession of a brand new folding mobile that Monday.
Why did he change providers?
She wondered aloud. But Signor Busacca's only response was another, "Boh," which is short in Italian for, "I don't have a clue."
"Where's the best place to go when you want information?"
Poldi asked me later, only to supply the answer herself.
"You go to the waterhole, because all the animals always go there, big and small alike. Predators or prey, they're all attracted to the water, and folk are no different. And where, I ask you, is the waterhole in Torre Acquedafi?"
"The old bottling plant, you mean?"
Poldi sighed. "I was talking figuratively."
"The bar?"
"Cento punti,"
she exclaimed, and took another swig of her drink. Poldi had long been a familiar figure in the bar Gelateria Cocuzza, of course, because that was where she partook every afternoon of a mulberry granita with cream top and bottom and a brioche on the side. Fragrantly, in a white caftan and gold gladiator sandals, plus dramatic eyeliner and plenty of rouge, she used to sail into the bar like a cruise liner visiting a provincial marina. Always around 5, when the houses opened up after a long, sweltering afternoon, and the whole town set off on its passeggiata. Since there were no shop windows to graze on, the promenaders would take a brief stroll along the esplanade before veering off towards the air-conditioned paradise of the bar like comets that have ventured too close to the sun. No wonder, for wafting out of the bar's 2 ventilators from morning to night, except on Tuesdays, came a wonderfully polar breeze laden with the promise of vanilla, almond milk, coffee and aromatic substances calculated to arouse ecstasy in anyone not made of stone. Outside in the square, the Sicilian summer afternoon shimmered like a mirage, but the interior was dominated by the arctic hum of the ventilators and air conditioning, which dried off your sweaty armpits and made you forget the August heat for the duration of a gelato. 8 varieties of ices were displayed in creamy, glistening mounds alongside fresh cream cakes filled with wild strawberries, almond pastries, cornetti, brioche, and marzipan fruit. Scenting the air at the far end of the counter were golden arancini, pizzette, and tramezzini, and slumbering behind it, hidden deep beneath aluminium lids, were granitas and bottles of ice-cold almond milk. Guarantees, in short, of a kindly god's existence. However, this impression was dispelled as soon as you entered the bar and looked into the face of Signora Cocuzza, who sat behind her till with an expression of such sadness it almost wrung your heart. How old was she? Nobody knew for sure. 50? 60? 100? She might have been a ghost. Frail and thin, she exuded a faint odour of mothballs and eternity. All Poldi had managed to discover was that her husband had died 10 years earlier. By contrast, her 2 grown-up sons looked the picture of health, their August lethargy notwithstanding, as they lounged behind the bar with their plucked eyebrows, upper arm tribal tattoos, delinquent buzz cuts and football strips. Signora Cocuzza never smiled and seldom spoke. She merely operated the cash register, handed you a voucher, contorted her face into a kind of rictus, and then went on staring into space as if every transaction cost her another vital spark. This couldn't fail to arouse Poldi's curiosity, which was why she patronized the bar for more than just its delicious granitas. She had spotted right away that Signora Crocuzza must once have been a very beautiful woman, but she could also tell that the decrepit creature was profoundly miserable, for, as I have already said, Poldi knew a thing or two about mental anguish.
"Forgive me, Signora, but have you seen or heard of Valentino in the last few days?"
The question seemed to percolate through Signora Cocuzza's consciousness very slowly. She was still holding out the voucher for Poldi's granita.
"You know who I mean,"
Poldi persisted, taking her voucher.
"Valentino Candela. The boy simply vanished into thin air 3 days ago. He may have turned up here in the meantime, not that I'm worried."
Signora Cocuzza almost imperceptibly shook her head, as if that alone cost her a superhuman effort.
"I'm sorry," she whispered,
and relapsed into silence. Loath to press her further, Poldi started to take her voucher over to the counter. But Signora Cocuzza wasn't finished yet.
"Donna Poldina?"
It was almost unintelligible, just a wisp of a voice. Surprised by this unexpected personal invocation, Poldi promptly returned to the till. She saw the sad signora take a ballpoint from the pocket of her apron, effortfully as though it weighed a ton, and scribble something on a slip of paper, an address in Ashiriali.
"His parents,"
whispered Signora Cocuzza, handing it over. Poldi thought for a moment. It was on the tip of her tongue to ask how Signora Cocuzza knew the address, but she left it at that for the time being. She merely thanked the woman, handed back the voucher, and changed her order. An afternoon in August, as already mentioned. This meant, first, that it was hot, and secondly, that Poldi wasn't really sober. Nevertheless, she gallantly piloted her Alfa to Ashiriali with, on the passenger seat, a kilo of gelato in a polystyrene tub prettily wrapped in floral paper and adorned with a bow. Ashiriali wasn't far, practically round the corner, but the winding, narrow provinciale, enclosed on either side by high old walls of volcanic stone, proved a sore trial to Poldi in her condition. She had to keep swerving to avoid the lemon transporters that came thundering towards her. Just before Santa Tecla, a lorry laden with mature palm and olive trees shot out of the gates of a big market garden. Poldi just managed to slam on her brakes in time. The lorry driver tooted her furiously, turned out onto the road, and roared off. Poldi pulled up on the verge for a moment, breathing heavily, and stared at the big gateway with a neon sign beside it. It read, "Piante Russo." Damn nearly squashed by a load of palm trees, she thought, shaking her head. Some mess that would have been. Although she didn't know her way around Ashiriali, Poldi found the address on the outskirts in double-quick time. She always found her way around wherever she was, from Jakarta to Lima, because she had an infallible trick. She kept asking directions. Regardless of the horns blaring behind her, she would pull up every 100 yards and question the first person she saw. This procedure was proof against misinformation from practical jokers, and Poldi always wound up at her destination with the precision of a sat-nav. Maria and Angelo Candela were both under 50, but looked older. Unemployed for the last 4 years, they lived on social security and the little money Valentino brought home. Their small apartment smelt of cigarettes, onions, and despair. But Poldi was quick to notice the flat-screen TV. Valentino's parents didn't even look surprised when she turned up on their doorstep so unexpectedly.
"Valentino has told us a lot about you, Donna Poldina," said Maria, hurriedly spooning the gelato into 3 sundae glasses. "I feel like we already know you quite well. Where is Valentino now?"
The Candelas exchanged a worried glance that wasn't lost on Poldi.
"We don't know," Angelo said in a low voice. "We haven't heard from him for 3 days.
Does he often do this sort of thing?"
The Candelas shook their heads and spooned up their ice cream before it melted completely. Or, thought Poldi, to avoid having to reply. And you've absolutely no idea where he might be.
Heads were shaken again, and spoons tinkled against Sunday glasses. Poldi didn't believe them. Meditatively, she licked her spoon. The chocolate and pistachio ice creams had run into each other. They tasted sweet and bitter and salty. Like tears and unfulfilled hopes, she thought. All at once, too, as usual in this country.
Please don't misunderstand me, she said, mustering her best Italian. I don't mean to interfere in your private affairs, but I can see you're worried. I'm worried, too, because, well, he may be in trouble.
They both winced at the word trouble. Something deep inside Maria seemed to break adrift. It came bubbling up to the surface in the form of an anguished sigh.
It was when I heard that sigh, if not before, Poldi told me later, that I knew Valentino was really up the creek in some way. I'm an expert on trouble and sighs like that, that's why. Red alert, know what I mean? I guessed his parents had already given him up for lost, and that they wouldn't tell me anything more. Omerta, and so on. That was when this idea popped into my head. That I had to find him, Valentino, I mean, and find him in a hurry. And that was the only reason why I pinched that little bit of mosaic.
Poldi resolutely laid her spoon aside and looked Maria in the eye.
Might I see his room?
Many thanks for the ice cream, Signora Poldi, Angelo said formally. But it would be better if you left now.
Maria glanced sharply at him and rose to her feet.
But first, of course you can see the boy's room.
Valentino's room resembled that of any young man who still lives at home. An unmade bed, clothes scattered around, an ancient laptop hooked up to a game console, Ferrari posters and pin-ups on the walls. The place smelt of mothballs and weed. A magnificent cannabis plant was thriving in a pot on the window ledge. While Poldi was looking around keenly, Maria lingered in the doorway as if afraid of disturbing the spirits that inhabited the room.
That's a variety of cannabis you can't smoke, she said. He only keeps it for decoration because it's so pretty.
Poldi kept her thoughts to herself. On a chest of drawers, she spotted some German textbooks, some Japanese mangas, and a row of colourful little tesserae that glittered in the sunlight. Bright shards of ceramic glazed on one side, none bigger than a fingertip. Lying at the outermost edge of these was a yellow crystal of the kind one can sometimes be lucky enough to find on Etna. Pretty to look at, it was a rhomboid prism about an inch across and growing on a porous stone. Poldi picked it up, and when she replaced it, her fingers smelt faintly of sulphur. She took a picture of the little ensemble with her mobile phone, and, whoops, before she knew it, she'd surreptitiously snaffled one of the glazed shards. Unacceptable behaviour, but she'd acted on impulse, genetically programmed, as she put it to me. The thing is, there's something else one should know about my Auntie Poldi. Her father had been a detective chief inspector in Augsburg. Homicide. Georg Oberreiter solved the Nölden case, as one or two people may recall, and even though Poldi had spent her life trying to slough off her parents, her parental home, and her claustrophobic suburban background like a cat shaking water off its fur, it has to be conceded that blood is thicker than water. Oberreiter blood included. Poldi was simply pre-programmed. Maria accompanied her to the door.
Thanks again for the ice cream. If we hear anything from Valentino, I'll call you at once. Perhaps you'll pay me a visit sometime. Then we can have a little chat. I'd like that.
Maria shook her head and sighed again, as only a mother can sigh who knows her child is beyond help.
He used to work for Russo sometimes, she whispered. At the Vivaio, you know.
Poldi remembered the lorry load of palm trees that had missed her by a whisker. Piante Russo.
You mean the big tree nursery beside the Provinciale?
Maria nodded.
Yes, near Femmina Morta.
Femmina Morta. That triggered another vague memory.
Diminutive and already half eroded by oblivion, it whirled around the convolutions of Poldi's brain and then, silent as a snowflake, drifted down to join her images of the last day Valentino was with her. Images of a nervous Valentino who was toting a half-full sack of cement up the stairs to the roof to patch a leak there. A somewhat dejected Valentino, she now recalled, who smoked too much, activated a brand new mobile with a TIM card, and spoke of having to go somewhere that evening. Somewhere by the name of Femmina Morta.
Could you tell me where it is?
Femmina Morta wasn't easy to find, for it was neither a town nor a restaurant, so not signposted, but merely the unofficial name of an estate bordering the Provinciale and right next door to the Russo nursery. Since the lava stone wall beside the road obscured any view of the properties beyond it, and since there was no signpost and Poldi saw no one she could ask, she had to drive back and forth several times before she finally spotted the narrow entrance. From there, an almost impassable farm track skirted the nursery's stone wall for several hundred yards. Beyond it, sprinkler systems hummed and diggers roared as they transported mature palm trees to and fro. Guided by Maria's description, Poldi sent the Alpha labouring over hundreds of potholes to an old archway wreathed in bougainvillea and flanked by two columns. Enthroned on one of them sat a sullen-looking lion guardant, with a coat of arms featuring lilies in its paws. The lion on the other side was missing. Beyond the archway lay a miniature paradise. Femmina Morta. A somewhat dilapidated Sicilian country house from the 18th century, built of tuff and lime-washed pink, almost entirely swathed in bougainvillea and jasmine, and set in the midst of a subtropical garden thick with palm trees, oleander bushes, hibiscus, and avocado, apricot, and lemon trees. And not far away in the background, with its flanks outspread like the wings of a dark guardian angel, Etna.
Not a soul.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.